Well, one murderous cop has been convicted. Who knows how many more there are to go?
Hey, poor! Hey, poor! Hey, poor! You don't have to be poor anymore! Jesus is here!
The loudspeaker spoke up and said,
greetings, fellow worker slaves, podcasting at 128 kilobits from the Fortress of Squalitude, not far from the Redneck Mecca. This is the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. I'm your host, Tucker. Professor Fuzznuts is busy walking across my desk. Ash, Buddha, and Lord Squeakington are in my room. Yes, it's a podcast hosted by a guy and his cats. Get over it. This is a news show episode where I and Hertzie cover stories in the news that are related to things like atheism, secularism, science, or we find just plain interesting. Next episode will be a chapter or two, maybe, from a Gnostic text. I don't know if we'll actually get a whole chapter out, considering how long it took us to get those few lines from the last one. The biggest news, of course, happened after Hertzie and I recorded this, and that's of Derek Chauvin being convicted of the murder of George Floyd. If we lived in a civilized country, such a verdict would not be a surprise. Unfortunately, we don't, and this clip of Malcolm X seems relevant.
However, that we're making progress in this country and worldwide?
No. I will never say that progress is being made. If you stick a knife in my back 9 inches and pull it out 6 inches, there's no progress.
Mm-hmm.
You pull it all the way out, that's not progress. The progress is healing the wound that the blow made. And they haven't even begun to pull a knife out, much less try and heal the wound.
They won't
even admit the knife is there.
I also want to point out that the only reason Chauvin was arrested, let alone charged and convicted, is because Darnella Frazier, a 17-year-old girl, streamed the murder to Facebook and millions of people marched in protest. Please, anytime you see a cop stopping somebody, film it. Stream it to Facebook. And as if to underscore the problems with policing in America, at the same time the guilty verdicts in the Chauvin trial were being announced, police in Columbus, Ohio, shot and killed a 16-year-old girl, and then said to bystanders, "Blue Lives Matter." The killing of Makia Bryant is particularly problematic. The body cam videos show that Makia was apparently intending to stab someone and was shot after refusing to drop the knife she was holding. Assuming, for the sake of argument, that the officer acted in the only way he could in such a situation, we need to ask ourselves how we got to a point where a 16-year-old girl who'd been living in foster care would find herself wielding a knife against other people, and that the only solution the police responding to the scene had was to shoot her. Was there something that could have been done before this to prevent the situation from happening? Did Makia have a psychological problem that wasn't being properly treated because healthcare in America is shit? Were the folks who worked in the foster home that Makia had been living in adequately trained in things like identifying children who need psychological help? Was the home properly inspected and meeting the state standards, or was the home exempt from such things because of ties to a religious organization? Are the state standards for such places adequate to spot problems and ensure the safety of everyone who lives there? Is it possible that had the officer been trained differently or had different equipment that he could have stopped Makia in the few seconds he had to act without killing her? I don't know, but I'd be willing to bet that we'll never get the kind of investigation that we need to answer those questions. I think that at most we'll get an investigation that might point out a problem or two, says the shooting was justified, and largely leaves it at that. There might be some disciplinary action handed out to the officer who said Blue Lives Matter to the people there, but I'm dubious. even if there was no other way that the cop could have responded in that situation, the simple fact is that he took a human life in the course of his job. And our goal should be to ensure that this happens as little as possible. So we should treat it the same way we do when someone is killed by a defective product. You look at everything leading up to the moment of death and see what steps could have been taken to prevent a repeat of the process. If there's problems with the foster care system, those need to be fixed. We already know that there's huge problems with the healthcare system in America, especially when it comes to things like mental health. And if Makia had been white, I doubt that we'd see much more of an investigation than we'll see in the wake of this shooting. America simply doesn't care for the poor, who are primarily the ones in foster care, very much at all, regardless of color. I do not know if we'll ever get to the point in this country where we genuinely value human life. Fortunately, most of the news we cover in this episode isn't nearly so dark, and since this episode is going to be a long one, let's go ahead and get to it now.
This is a fantasy business, Reverend. You can have any truth you want.
And so can you. Isn't that why you're here?
Isn't that why you are?
We're going to start with Brazil, according to the NY Post. Brazil's new gigantic Christ statue is even bigger than Rio's. I'm guessing they're having a contest. My Christ is bigger than your Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Anything your Christ can do, my Christ can do better. For anybody who's an Annie Get Your Gun fan.
I've heard that song. I didn't know what musical it was from.
Yeah, when I was in elementary school, we did a three song review where we did like three tiny things. It was fun. Rio de Janeiro, blah, blah, blah. Iconic and towering Christ the Redeemer. Oh, sorry, cat. Has met its vertical match. An even taller Jesus statue that is near complete a half hour west of in southern Brazil. Measuring 140 feet, the new Jesus statue that's now rising over the city of Encantado, called Christ the Protector, is 15 feet taller than its coastal counterpart. So is it the exact same statue?
No. If you look at the photo in the article, you can see it's different, and in fact it's really weird looking.
Oh great, now I actually have to click the link. Oh, that is a hella detailed face.
Yeah, and it doesn't look right.
No, the beard is white, like salt white.
Yeah, I know, it's like
and the hair is like dark, which, I mean, this could be trick of the light, too.
Yeah, but it's like, but you're just looking at it going, he looks like an old man.
Well, and at the same time, it's like, you know, if it's a trick of the light, you would think that the photographer would try to get a better shot then.
Yeah.
However, yeah, it's the same pose as the one in Rio, but it's definitely not the same. So far, it looks kind of pixelated.
Yeah.
There's something about the hands.
Are you familiar with the architecture style called Brutalism?
Nope.
Okay. Basically, that's where they just take concrete forms and do a building. If you've ever seen pictures of the FBI headquarters in Washington, D.C., that's the brutalist architecture style. And it's not very popular, and it's also very hard to maintain. Because there have been some good-looking buildings made with it, but a lot of them are pretty hideous.
That looks like a bloody jail.
Yeah, well, that's...
I'm looking at the FBI headquarters in D.C.
Yeah. Yeah. In fact, there's... One of the Boston City government buildings is in a brutalist style. I forget which one it is. I think it's like the City Hall. And a lot of people have said, let's get rid of it. And somebody did an engineering study on it to getting rid of the building. And basically the only practical way you could get rid of it is literally to use the same nuke they used in on Japan in the war.
Wow.
So they're stuck with this thing in the middle of the city and everybody hates it. It's like called the Darth Vader building or something. It's so idiots.
See, they need to have, like, the if you ever get the chance to look up the Ramsey County Courthouse, it looks a little brutal on the outside, maybe. Mm-hmm. It was built in the 1930s, and it is a gorgeous building. I did jury duty there a while ago, and I got to take a tour, and they're like, there's no way you could build this building for the price that they built it nowadays. It's impossible.
Yeah.
Because it was the 1930s. They were able to get stuff for, well, cheaper.
Yeah.
Anyways, so this Jesus statue, it definitely has a look.
Yeah, it does.
It was $320,000.
Yeah.
Was it really just that?
Well, don't forget. I mean, we're talking about Brazil. Their standard of living isn't quite what ours is.
Fair.
But you
still
know,
I mean, that's cheap for a statue.
Yeah. Well, I just like I, you know. I wish somebody would raise money to build one in Brazil of a Brazilian scientist that size.
I don't think there's many scientists, I would say, probably wouldn't want a statue that big.
I know, but can you imagine how it would piss off people?
Fair.
You know, and I mean, Brazil is, you know, it's sort of like the United States. Everybody knows who Jesus was, so they don't really need another giant statue of him.
Well, just in case they find the one person who somehow miraculously escaped that. I always love, like, because, you know, I listen to GAM or God Awful Movies. I always love the number of times where it's the atheist is like, or even, you know, someone who's Jewish is like, oh, well, who's Jesus? It's like, are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah.
When I was in second grade, maybe I would be, you know, understanding of that. When somebody is 30 and living in especially a small town in the middle of nowhere America, there's no way you're getting away from Jesus.
No. And speaking of GAM, have you listened to the latest episode?
Of course.
Okay, so I have a question.
I potentially have an answer.
It was, I'm sitting there and I'm listening to them because, you know, they're making fun of
that. Oh, yeah, that was Roe versus Wade. Oh, I got to listen to that one again. I love it when they have an anti-abortion movie.
Yeah, well, the thing is, like, you know, they're laughing at, you know, oh, ho, ho, all these dudes don't know anything about women. Oh, ho, ho, they don't know. And it's like, but this podcast is a sausage fest right now. Mm-hmm. And I understand that. I understand, you know, Andrew's a lawyer, so you want him on there. But there's also...
Cara Santamaria?
Well, yeah. Well, there's Sharon Frankel.
That is also true. I would love to have to see her on there. As far as the sausage fest, at least those guys are willing to learn and listen to women when they're talking. The thing about the people in these movies and these movements is they have these ideas of what periods are. The women around them aren't going to correct them because
that would be bad.
Or if they try to correct them, it's not going to go well.
Yeah.
And it's one of those things where they're not going to expand their mind and go, oh, wait, women can't control their period. That's just not going to happen.
Yeah, but it just kind of, you know, it's like, oh, you really should have had, you know.
Honestly, I'm just laughing with them because I don't, that they deserve to be laughed at.
Oh, that's true. But it was like, it just sort of, some of it sort of lost its weight, what they were saying.
It's probably going to become one of my favorites, just like, let's see here. Oh, what's the other one? The Life Zone. Allison's Choice. What's the most prolific murderer? The one about Gosnell?
No, I don't remember.
Yeah. Like I said, the anti-abortion ones are usually my favorite.
Yeah. But that was just, you know, it's like, you know, of course, I
agree. I'd love to have Sharon on there. It's their show, though.
Yeah, I know. And it's all, well, I mean, I'm also really good friends with Zandi Anderson, who she did volunteer work for years at an abortion clinic in Alabama. So that's pretty.
I don't know. Send a message to the guys.
No one doesn't answer my emails, and we'll leave it at that. Okay.
See, this is why I should have gone second. The second, I swear you do this on purpose.
I did.
The second story is always one of the best.
It was random chance how they ended up that way. It was. From NewYorkTimes.com, Liberty University sues Jerry Falwell Jr. for $10 million. See, and I could build a bunch of statues of scientists in Brazil. That would be awesome.
Okay. Like, even the $300,000 in Brazil, I mean, how much money could be done doing literally anything else good?
That's true. But at the same time, symbolic gestures, it's hard to put a price tag on them.
Fine, then do a symbolic gesture of something else.
Like a giant scientist statue.
Well, I mean, admittedly, yes. Now, this $10 million, like, on one hand, I'm glad Liberty University is doing this. On the other hand, I'm like, I don't want them to get $10 million.
Well, they'd just be getting the money back, because that's about what he got in his severance package, if I recall correctly. Anyways,
Liberty... I still don't want them to have $10 million.
I know. Liberty University has sued Jerry Falwell Jr. for $10 million, exacerbating the messy divorce between the Christian University and its former president, whose family name has been synonymous with the university since its founding. Yeah, because his dad helped found it.
Yeah, I was going to say, when I saw the words messy divorce, I was kind of hoping that Falwell was going through what David A.R. White went through with the divorce, and I was like, oh.
Well,
and then I got sad.
Yeah, well, I have a feeling that'll happen once all the money issues are settled. You know, once Falwell gets all, you know, once this court case is settled, I'm sure Falwell and his wife will bail on each other. Anyways, the suit filed on Thursday alleges breach of contract and fiduciary duty. It claims that Mr. Falwell withheld scandalous and potentially damaging information from Liberty's Board of Trustees while negotiating a generous new contract for himself in 2019 under false pretenses. Mr. Falwell also failed to disclose and address his personal impairment by alcohol, the suit alleges. I thought they already said that, you know, it was public knowledge amongst the faculty that him and his wife were diddling the pool boy.
Don't confuse the issue with facts here.
Last August, Mr. Falwell claimed that he was being threatened with extortion by a man who had a years-long sexual relationship with Mr. Falwell's wife, Becky, while Jerry was in the closet, literally, watching. The suit claims that by keeping the sexual entanglement and resulting extortion, I love how they put extortion in quotes, a secret, Mr. Falwell endangered and later damaged Liberty's reputation. Instead of divulging the active threat to Liberty's board, Falwell Jr. chose personal protection, the suit claims. Yeah. And of course, nobody's willing to comment on this.
Nope.
Yeah.
Fall in?
Yeah,
for the Falwell?
No.
Katie Boom.
Yeah, so, but it'll be nice to, when this goes to court, because all kinds of stuff will come out.
That is very possible. There could be a whole bunch of stuff that comes out that could potentially take Liberty and just throw it into the Stone Age.
Well, they're kind of already there.
More into the Stone Age.
Do you know what history is, mate? It's layers. The Romans make a layer. The Saxons, the Medievals, Georgians, Victorians. Your mum, my mum. So we have to take a peek.
Per livescience.com, ancient people may have created art, cave art while hallucinating. I go back and forth with this. On one hand, I'm definitely legalized the drugs. Yeah, let's get this stuff settled. I also have a thing where there's so many things where it's like, oh, you have to be high to do this. And I'm like, no, you don't. Like, there's a coworker I knew who was like, oh man, you had to be high to get a really good D&D campaign. And I'm like, no, you can DM a really good D&D campaign sober.
Yeah, in fact, it usually works better that way, I've found.
Yeah, actually that.
Because you get high, and pretty soon everybody forgets what they're doing, and then...
How good are you at mathing while high?
Right.
I remember he was talking about, like, even the creation of D&D had to be while high. And I'm like, guess with an XJW? Probably not. So, anyways, it's always a thing where it's like, oh, they're high, and like, oh, musicians, they always are better high, and I'm like, are they?
Yeah.
Are they though?
There's what's known as state learning, which means that you can learn, like, you can get drunk or high and learn how to do something while you're drunk or high. You won't be able to do it very well when you're sober. But you get drunk or high again, and you can do it again.
See, that's an interesting piece, because, like, when I was taking some accounting classes, I had a particularly annoying one.
Mm-hmm.
And so I did a bunch of studying, and then I took the practice test tipsy.
Because
I was like, if I can take it tipsy, I should be fine sober. I can't remember if I passed the test or not, which I was not tipsy for. I was stone cold sober. But that was like 2-3 years ago, and I passed the class, so I really don't care how I did on that one test.
Yeah.
Anyways, but the idea is that they went into oxygen-depleted caves to paint while having out-of-body experiences and hallucinations.
Yeah,
I guess. Do we know that they were oxygen-deprived caves at that time? Things do change.
Yeah, that is a question. Because I know the there's a cave in France, not the Lascaux, but it's the subject of the I can't think of his name now. He's the director who did Grizzly Bear Man or Grizzly Man, and then he did he did a whole bunch of movies, you know, dramatic movies, and then he's now just said I'm just going to direct documentaries, and he's in The Mandalorian as one of the actors.
Oh yeah.
Anyways, he did a I can't hear you.
I'm still here.
Okay.
I'm just being very quiet.
Okay. Anyways, he did a documentary called Cave of Forgotten Dreams. And it's about this cave in France that they discovered, like, right at the tail end of World War II. And it has all these fancy cave paintings in there. And they only allow so many people in it each year because they're trying to preserve it. And it originally was very open. And at some point in its history, before it was... And what caused it to be abandoned was there was a cave-in at the front, and it sealed the front end off. So, it's entirely possible that that cave would have had higher oxygen levels than what they're figuring on in this. And... let's see here, the dates on these, I'm fairly certain that humans had discovered things like hallucinogenic mushrooms when these things were going on.
Because I was going to say, that's the other thing, it's like, what, they couldn't take mushrooms?
Yeah, mushrooms or Datura, aka morning glory seeds.
Yeah, that's good, so there's plenty of stuff that will do that. It's also interesting because they talk about what the pictures are, and it's the black and red primarily showing animals, some hand stencils, handprints, geometric abstract signs, and I'm like, okay, but we've seen that many places where we've seen ancient art. So it's one of those, I'm like, I don't think they have to be high to paint that.
No. but I bet in a lot of places they were. Just because humans have a long history of using recreational pharmaceuticals.
That is true.
So.
However, humans are also creative with or without pharmaceuticals.
That's true. But, you know, in a lot of societies, paintings like these are tied to religious rituals, and those religious rituals often involve mind-altering substances. Not necessarily hallucinogens, it could be alcohol.
That's also true. Now, either way, they would go into these dark caves, and I mean, one of the questions they're trying to answer is, why would they go into these deep, dark spaces? And it's like, I don't know, because humans are weird and curious? I mean, have you met us?
Yeah.
We're all a little weird. Some people like going spelunking for fun.
Yeah. Well, also, I mean, you know, if you're having some kind of religious experience, a lot of people go isolate themselves while they're having it, regardless if they're on anything or not. So.
Well, we should move on to the next one.
Okay. From bristol.ac.uk, ancient pottery reveals the first evidence for honey hunting in prehistoric West Africa. A team of scientists led by the University of Bristol with colleagues from Goethe University, Frankfurt, has found the first evidence for ancient honey hunting locked inside pottery fragments from prehistoric West Africa dating back some 3,500 years ago. So, I mean, that's a long time, but not really when you're talking about human civilizations just in Africa.
Well, yeah, I was going to say, haven't we found honey before? about 3,000-year-old honey in Egypt.
Yeah. Because of the area, we don't have any record, very many records of what kinds of food these people ate. So this is like the first big clue, because the Bristol team were carrying out chemical analysis of more than 450 prehistoric potsherds from the central Nigerian Nok culture to investigate what foods they were cooking in their pots. The Nok people are known for the remarkable large-scale terracotta figurines and early iron production in West Africa. That is fucking remarkable. Iron production 3,500 years ago was rare anywhere in the world. Around the first millennium BC, acidic soils at Nok archaeological sites meant that organic remains, such as animal bones and plants, did not survive very well, so what Nok people were eating was somewhat of a mystery. So, and they had beeswax in them, and they had other things that they could, they found as far as food residue. That gives us a better idea. And what these people would have known is that honey is a good preservative. They just wouldn't have realized it would work so well for so long. Because that's one of the things it talks about, that they put, they like put something in a pot, like meat or something, and then covered it with honey.
Look, I was going to say, it's interesting. It looks like they also ate the larva as well.
Could be.
If you have to eat, you gotta eat.
Yeah, it's protein.
That's an interesting thing, because it reminds me of a documentary I was watching at one point, and I can't remember what it was, but it took place in Australia. And there was a bunch of the indigenous people there. They went out to the plains to go have, a traditional meal, because traditional meals are much healthier for them. And of course, the guys go off and they go hunting for a kangaroo with their gun, and we're going to be the dudes. Where the women, they go around and they gather some lizards and some other food products, like some vegetables, maybe some grains, and they put together a meal. And of course, the guys don't get a kangaroo. And it was just kind of funny, because it was like, how often did that happen? The hunting party went out for hunting, and the gathering party just went, have some food.
Yeah. Well, what most people don't realize is that hunter-gatherer societies only spend about 4 hours a day meeting their basic needs. The rest of the time, it's socializing, sleeping, whatever. It's...
makes sense.
Yeah, it's like, okay, so we live longer, but they get to have more fun in their 35 years.
Yeah, but they didn't have computers or internet.
True.
Or vaccines.
True. And like I said.
Or painkillers.
Some of them.
Painkillers are kind of a, yeah, but it wasn't as good.
I don't know. Opium's probably pretty good.
Yeah, but it wasn't morphine yet.
Yeah.
Let's put it this way. I am willing to live now where it might suck in some cases, but I'm not going to die of a toothache that is mind-bogglingly painful that we can't take care of.
Yeah.
Yeah. I will eat bug larva, though.
That makes one of us. Yeah, I read an article. This guy, he had his intestinal bacteria sampled, and then he spent a week in Africa living with a tribe, and he went back to civilization and had his gut bacteria sampled and analyzed again, and it had vastly changed just over that week because he was eating wildly different things than he normally did.
Maybe it's a little early. Maybe the time is not quite yet. But those other worlds, promising untold opportunities, beckon. Silently, they orbit the sun, waiting.
All right. Space.com. Scientists get more great looks at the first black hole ever photographed. The supermassive black hole at the heart of the galaxy M87 is coming into... It should be M86. It'd be so much more funnier if it was 86.
Yeah, it would.
Universe, what are you doing? But it is coming into sharper and sharper focus. 2 years ago, astronomers with the Event Horizon Telescope project unveiled the imagery of that black hole, which lies 55 million light years from Earth and is as massive as 6.5 billion suns.
Yeah.
These photos?
Yeah. I was just going to say, have you seen that photo that came out when they released the first images, and it shows the scale, how big the black hole is compared to our solar system?
I was going to say, well, wasn't it like a pebble compared to the sun?
Like the inner edge of the glowing ring is where Voyager 1 is. That's how big this thing is.
Damn.
Yeah. And Voyager 1 is 150 times farther away from the sun than the Earth is.
Well, let's hope that the black hole stays far away.
Yeah.
I'd rather not get sucked up by a giant black hole that we cannot escape.
Yeah.
However, being 55 million light years from Earth, probably not going to be our problem.
No. And let me send you a link to this tweet. That somebody did. I'll do it via Facebook if you've got that open.
Mm-hmm.
It's an animation that NASA just did of these two black holes that are orbiting one another. And it is mind-blowing. Because you see... as the one goes around the other, you can see the reflection of, or the image of the one in the rear pops around to the front one. I mean, it is just... It is just that, amazing.
That is pretty cool.
Yeah, and they got detailed images of everything in that thread, but that's really cool. And unfortunately, Stephen Hawking did not live to see that. And it's like Carl Sagan died the year before we confirmed the existence of exoplanets. Just a bit of a bummer.
Well, there's always going to be something.
Yep. But it's...
All I can think about is the Babylon 5.
I couldn't get into that, so...
T'was good.
My problem was, I watched an episode, and I could tell everything was a set. You know, I could... I mean, they did some good stuff, and I was actually quite familiar with J. Michael Straczynski's work before he got the series. But I tuned in to watch it all excited, and I was like, I can't get over the fact that I'm staring at a set. It just didn't have the realism that I was that you got from other shows at the time, like Trek.
Yeah, it wasn't really a problem for me. I would like to rewatch it, because admittedly, when I was watching it, it was when it was coming out.
Yeah, so you were like 8?
Ish?
Yeah.
What really bugged me was when the last bit went to cable.
Yeah.
Because we didn't have cable growing up, so...
Yeah, well, he was lucky to get that... because they canceled the series early on him, and then they got the cable deal. So, okay, well, let's hit the next one from mars.nasa.gov. Work progresses toward Ingenuity's first flight on Mars. The Ingenuity team has identified a software solution for the command sequence issue identified on Sol 49, April 9th. And by the way, the JPL crew, or team, that's working on the Mars rovers lives on Martian time during the missions. And Mars has a 26-hour day. So they have like a calendar and clock thing all set up for them so that they can keep... They can live on Martian time. During a planned high-speed spin-up test for the helicopter's rotors, over the weekend, the team considered and tested multiple potential solutions to this issue, including that minor modification and reinstallation of Ingenuity's flight control software is the most robust path forward. You remember when you would download a program and it wouldn't work, and then you'd just delete it and reinstall it, and that'd fix it? This software update will modify the process by which the two flight controllers boot up, allowing the hardware and software to safely transition to the flight state. Modifications to the flight software are being independently reviewed and validated today and tomorrow in test beds at JPL. It's not really surprising because they didn't have, they couldn't really test that thing here on Earth very well, because they didn't have a chamber that they could get to the atmospheric pressure that was really large enough for it, if I'm not mistaken. I read something about it, and I forget exactly what it was, but they had problems because, you know, there just really wasn't a good way to test it here on Earth. And of course, they've got the issue with the temperatures, because it gets so cold there.
Well, they can just use Minnesota. I love it when people are like, oh man, this cold is going to be a problem. And like the entire northern area of America and Canada and stuff looks and goes, gee, if only you could find a place that was really fucking cold.
They use, for a lot of the tests, NASA uses a desert in Chile that is the highest desert in the world, because it's very cold up there, because, you know, the mountain's tall enough that it's actually cold where the desert is, and the air is thinner. Not as thin as Mars, of course, but it's still thinner than you get down at ground level. And I don't think Minnesota's known for its mountains.
No. However, we are very cold.
Yeah. Well, the car companies do a lot of their testing there and in places like Alaska.
Let's see. Right now... What is the temperature right now? It is 51, and I have my windows open.
Yeah, that's about what it is here. That's 55 here. Which is a little cool for this time of year, but not terribly.
I would say for April 50s in Minnesota is pretty good.
Yeah, yeah. You remember, I forget the name of them, but you remember the IMAX that came out late 90s, early 2000s, that were the colorful plastic ones, sort of look like a gumdrop.
This is not ringing any bells.
They had like blue and silver, and they had different colors. Anyways, the computer chip in them is what's on the rover.
Hmm.
Yeah, so it's 21-year-old hardware. It's a 21-year-old hardware design, basically. And they're all running Linux. All of NASA stuff runs a special version of Linux.
Hmm.
And at one point in time, you could download that from the web. I don't know if you still can or not.
Somebody's probably got it.
Yeah, but they use... Well, one of the reasons why they use the older hardware is because they have to... they have to harden it against radiation, and it takes so long to do that, and they don't switch to newer chips frequently because you have an older established chip, you know how it's going to function. Whereas if you have a newer chip that you don't have a lot of experience with, you don't know what could happen with it and how things might go wrong. In the final years of the shuttle program, NASA was buying old computer gear off eBay to use for the shuttles because they knew how that equipment operated, so they didn't. If there was an emergency, they had a better handle on the situation than they would if they tried to upgrade certain things. So you want to take the next one?
Sure. I'm noticing a theme today. Just a little bit.
Well, I had to go back and add this one because I forgot about it. It was one I really wanted to put in.
Well, you sure you don't want to do this one?
No, I'll let you have it.
Okay, fair. Because I've looked at the next one and it's... All right, ABC7.com. Social filmmaker fundraises $750,000 to create a sculpture. See, even that I look at and I'm like, really? Just $750,000? To create a sculpture honoring Apollo 13 astronauts, art to be placed at NASA's Houston Space Center. And I think that's a lovely idea.
Yeah, and these aren't giant statues. These are...
No, that is also true. Like, not going to be 120 feet.
No.
Granted, they at least existed, so they still have a better reason for existing than the Jesus statue.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, I think that's a great idea, because, I mean, they were able to do something that definitely gave... everybody involved heart attacks about whether or not they'd be able to get them back, and then they did.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it was...
I think my favorite part of the movie was when the guy comes in with all of this random stuff to the engineers and goes, you have 15 minutes. Make this work. This is all they have.
Yeah, that was the movie. Fudged some facts here and there, but it accurately captured the oh shit factor that they were all going through. Because
okay, it may not have had that exact scene happen, but you know something similar to that probably did.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. And they all said the same thing. We never thought an accident like this could happen and the crew would survive. So, meaning they figured the crew would be killed when the thing blew up. And so they had to improvise, you know, they had various disaster plans and they had to improvise putting them all together to get the guys home and figure out what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
And some of that they actually did do on the fly. Like they woke people up in the middle of the night at MIT and said, "You have to rewrite the software program now," so they can do this or that. Yeah. Did you ever read the XKCD comic?
Yeah, long time ago.
There was one. Where, you know, guy sitting there at the computer and goes, "Oh, wow, they're making a movie about the Martian." And the other person goes, "What's that about?" And guy says, "You know that scene in Apollo 13 where he dumps all that stuff out on the table and says, you got to figure out how they could build this thing?" And the other person goes, "Yeah." And the first person goes, "That's the whole movie." That's what the whole movie is like. Which is pretty much what the book and the movie was like. I don't know if you've read or seen the movie or read the book or seen the movie. But that's the basic premise. He's trapped on Mars and everything goes wrong.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I mean,
but the guy that did this is a filmmaker.
Mm-hmm.
And which I think that's pretty cool. And
yeah, it'll be fun to watch.
Yeah. Yeah.
I saw a similar device in a Tarkalian vessel. It was capable of replicating almost any inanimate object.
If we had one of these in engineering, we could make all the spare parts we need. I wonder what else is on the menu.
Okay, so, next story from fizz.org. Finally, 3D printed graphene aerogels for water treatment. Graphene excels at removing contaminants from water, but it's not yet a commercially viable use of the Wonder Moon material. That could be changing. In a recent study, University of Buffalo engineers report a new process of 3D printing graphene aerogels that they say overcomes two key hurdles: scalability and creating a version of the material that's stable enough for repeated use for water treatment. So basically what it is they 3D printed an aerogel with graphene, which is pretty freaking remarkable. I don't know if you're familiar with what aerogels are or not.
Nope.
Basically, what they do is they take, like, say, literally a grain of sand, put it under a tremendous amount of pressure, and inject some kind of gas into it, and then when they release it, the grain of sand expands like 1,000 times, and it becomes the best insulator ever developed. And it's generally really expensive to do that, although the process has gotten cheaper. And this is the first time I've ever heard of them 3D printing them. So, you know, we've got a huge problem with crap in the water supply everywhere. And if this thing, which if they can do this and it's cheap, that will be really good. And interesting, it's in addition to graphene, which is just thin sheets of carbon, they mix in a synthetic version of stuff that mussel shells use to stick to things. And then bovine serum albuminum, a protein derived from cows. But yeah, it gets rid of heavy metals, which, hey, they could use that in Flint. And then use it in a lot of places around the world. If it's cheap, this will be really a big one. Okay, now you'll probably find this next story more interesting than I do.
That's asking a lot. So you put this stuff together.
Well, I know, but I'm guessing you haven't read it yet.
No, I have not. Now I see why you wanted me to go first. Aha! 3Dprint.com. 3D printing used to develop menstrual cup from female-owned brand. Cool. No, this is great, especially because it's what's been great is, as we've been going forward, the variety of being able to work with feminine hygiene has gotten better. For now, now we have actual specific underwear and cups, and it even talks about how some people even just prefer free bleeding, which, the idea of that being more acceptable. They've known for a while now that menstrual cups are healthier solutions for our body and the planet. I'll definitely go with the planet. I will go back and forth on healthier for body.
Yeah, that strikes me. It's one of those things. It's like, I obviously can't comment on specifics, but it's like, I'm not sure if that's really a great idea, but I don't know.
Well, here's my take with it. The body is going to do what the body is going to do.
Yeah.
And it's one of those, results may vary by person.
Yeah.
If you're going to go into, my own history, for quite a while, I used tampons all the time. And it got to the point where my body actually rejects most of them. I might get away with using a light one once. So I have not gone to the menstrual cups, also because right now my birth control makes my periods almost completely gone. I will miss that when I stop using it. But the other reason is because the idea of inserting something in myself, I'm like, I don't think that's going to make it any better, because I'm pretty sure it's the insertion of a thing that my body is rejecting.
Yeah.
So be it a cup or a tampon, I'm really not sure it's going to get any better. Now, that being said, it could be, I could be proven wrong. But either way, it's a huge thing. And one of the things that I do like with this, especially with the 3D printing, is the founder and CEO talks about how they have had cups that did not have the capacity for a heavy flow day and came with, cheap lint-producing cotton carrying bags, which would be awful, especially with a silicone cup.
Yeah.
So to be able to actually have something that is bigger and being able to print it on demand and such makes that a heck of a lot better. I know I've said it before, I am in love with 3D printing. I actually helped kickstart a thing for D&D with 3D printing, because I'm totally going to give the plans to my brother who has a 3D printer and go, okay, we need to talk.
Yeah,
it's like a bunch of dice towers and random crap like that.
Yeah. Well, and one of the things that I can see that this would be beneficial for is not everyone's shaped the same way. Mm-hmm. Some people may need a specialized shape, so being able to come up with that and then test it out. Is just a fantastic idea, if you ask me.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the idea that it's so much easier to make something special for somebody and such, and once you have the plans, great.
Yeah.
if somebody else comes along and goes, oh, hey, I have the same thing, it's that much easier to just pop out another one.
Yeah, yeah. And it's like I've said, you know, if I ever have the misfortune of losing a limb, I want a 3D printed replacement that looks like one of the Iron Man ones that they give kids. I don't want one that looks like a real arm. I want one that looks like an Iron Man thing.
Ooh, that's a really good question. What would I, if I lost a limb, what would I want it to look like?
Yeah, there was, I don't know. I forget what magazine printed the article, but it was talking about, you know, people who are amputees or who are born with a, you know, a condition where one of their limbs doesn't properly form, they really don't like any of the prosthetics, no matter how sophisticated they are, because they lack something. And it was a really interesting take, and it's like, wow, yeah. So, and they were saying they're starting now to see people work with the 3D printing stuff to come up with ones that those folks feel better about using.
Yeah.
I didn't realize we had such specialized clinics here in Iowa.
When science is on the march, nothing can stand in its way.
Once again, I'm jealous of your story.
I'm sorry. From Gizmodo.com, adorable porg pterosaur flapped above Jurassic China. As the sun sets over what will become northern China in 160 million years, something small dives between the trunks of tree ferns, intercepting a dragonfly mid-flight. That would be a young dragonfly. I believe back then they got really big, if I'm not mistaken. It lands in the canopy to gulp down its squirming prize. The big-eyed, arrestingly cute critter is a newly described species of pterosaur named Cynomacrops bondae. Apparently, evolution's answer to the question, what a frog, but also bat, but also dragon. So it looks like one of the porgs from that Star Wars movie.
This thing is so goddamn cute.
It is. It is.
Oh my god, this is so freaking adorable. Oh my gosh. People listening, for heaven's sakes, click on this link because it is so cute.
Yeah, it's like, that goes onto like my top list of dinosaurs that need to be cloned.
Yes! I want to have one that like just flies around and then lands on my shoulder and then is like gnaws on my ear.
Yeah.
Oh, D&D needs to make this a familiar.
Yeah, that would be pretty cool.
Yes! Considering the fact that my familiar is a dinosaur in my Pathfinder game, yes, 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 yes.
And of course, one thing we don't know about is, because I guess this is the only fossil they found so far of the thing, we don't know what its age was and whether it was a big one or, whether that was a full-grown adult or if it was a hatchling, basically.
Baby.
Yeah.
I mean, flying creatures can only get so big. Gravity is a thing.
Yeah, but some of the pterosaurs and pteranodons were huge.
You know, that's one thing I think about now. It's like, how long was their flight? Were they able to fly for a really long time? And was it because of something in the air? I mean, their bones had to be super brittle.
Yeah. Some of them, yeah, like the biggest one.
I shouldn't have clicked that.
The biggest one had a wingspan of 10 meters. The biggest pterosaur.
Jesus.
Yeah.
That's a bolt of fabric.
Yeah.
That may sound like a strange thing to compare that to. It makes sense in my head.
No, that's fine. That's fine. It's always good to find reference points that you can nail down. I take that back. The biggest one, they think it was 13 meters or 43 feet.
Damn.
Yeah. And they're not really sure how well they flew. Like, they think they may have just, like, you know, dove off of cliffs and just sort of glided around and then landed back on the cliffs. They didn't actually, you know, like, fly like a bird or anything, but then again.
Yeah, like I said, they almost can't.
Yeah.
Because it's too big. And I know that the makeup of the atmosphere was different. It was a more oxygen-rich environment. However, that doesn't change gravity.
Yeah, well, from the Wikipedia article, so, you know, take it with a grain of salt. Factors such as the warmer climate of the Mesozoic or higher levels of atmospheric oxygen have been proposed, but it is now generally agreed that even the largest pterosaurs could have flown in today's skies. Partly this is due to the presence of air sacs in their wing membranes, and that pterosaurs launched into flight using their front limbs in a quadruple stance similar to that of modern bats, a method faster and less energy taxing than the bipedal launching of modern birds.
Hmm.
Although,
well, and that also would... Oh, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, the higher oxygen levels back then may have made it easier for them to fly than it would be for them to fly today. They might, you know, they might feel like they're at the top of their altitude in today's world.
Well, I was going to say, and then also if you think about it, like today's birds are all, you know, descended from like Tyrannosaurus Rex.
Yeah.
Not exactly a flight-oriented creature back then.
No, no.
I was going to say, do we know what those... Because, I mean, I don't think the pterodactyl was technically a dinosaur.
That's one of those things that it's... they've gone back and forth on, and I don't remember where they've landed.
Yeah, I know that. So there is debate as to whether or not a pterodactyl is an actual dinosaur, and with that, there's kind of a question of like, okay, well, what does that mean?
Yeah, I don't. Yeah.
Well, speaking of doo-doo-doo-doos.
Mm-hmm.
According to bbc.co.uk/news. Human cells grown in monkey embryos spark ethical debate because people still keep thinking that humans are not monkeys. Or primates, I should say.
Yeah.
So first off, we're still primates.
Yep.
The research by the U.S.-Chinese team has sparked fresh debate in the ethics of such experiments. Science injected human stem cells, cells that have the ability to develop into many different body tissues, into, embryos. Macaque embryos. The developing embryos were studied for 20 days. And pro-lifers ignored them as usual. Their so-called...
I was just chuckling.
Other so-called mixed-species embryos, or chimeras, have been produced in the past with human cells implanted into sheep and pig embryos. Again, pro-lifers said nothing. The scientists were led by Professor Juan Carlos Isu... Juan, why did you have to have such a Juan Carlos Isupusa Belmont. I really suck at names. Of the Salk Institute in the U.S., who in 2017 helped make the first human pig hybrid. And probably descended from the Belmonts who hit Dracula upside the head. That, I swear, that was one of my favorite memes, is the whole Belmont Dracula thing. Have you seen that meme?
Uh-uh.
So, have you seen the Castlevania cartoon on Netflix?
No. I may have caught bits and pieces of it, but at some point.
If you get the chance, check it out. It's really good. I need to watch the last season. But the meme basically the scene is Belmont sees Dracula, and the first thing he does is just punches him in the face, knowing that this guy is Dracula, knowing that this guy is like the biggest baddie of all the baddies that he can meet in this world. Just runs up and punches him in the face. And the thing is, like, people are thinking, like, what is Dracula thinking? Because the first thing Dracula says is, "Ah, Belmont, how's the family?" And I think my favorite one they came up with is, okay, this asshole just came up and punched me in the face. There's only one group of people who is stupid, brave, and whatever else enough to do that. Belmont. Oh, it's so good. Going back to the actual article, it is interesting about the debate because there are a lot of questions about this, you know, and not just the religious questions.
Right.
Meh. While this may be great for advancing biomedical research and stuff, there is questions of, like, how is this going to affect, like, how far do we take some of these things?
Well,
you know, at one point do you call it quits, and then at what point is it technically murder?
Well, somebody posted a great comment online where I found this article, and it was, "Do you want Planet of the Apes? Because this is how you get Planet of the Apes."
That, and, you know, that kind of is the point, or at least part of the point, you know?
Yeah, well, and this is being done to figure out the shortage in transplantable organs, which, if we did what the French did, we wouldn't have that problem. In France, when you die, it's not, would you like to donate your organs to, you know, for transplant? It's, okay, they're dead, we're taking the organs. If you're religious, if you have a religious prohibition against that, then you have had to have it filled out before you died. Otherwise, it's an opt-out system rather than an opt-in system. So they don't have the shortages that we do. And they're already 3D printing organs, so we may not need to do this for much longer. But then again,
Well, the nice part about the 3D organs is that with luck, it'll be with the person's own DNA, which means we can act, which the rate of organ rejection will be less. However, I do see that at some point we may not ever have that, because there is going to be a time where there's because of course it's going to go to a whole bunch of stuff, and you have to have the first person who does it, and then it's going to be like, oh, only rich people can get it because we're America. And then once it gets to a certain point, you know, it'll equalize itself. However, even if it's just, okay, the rich people are getting it, it's like, okay, great, now we can start filling the donated organs with the people who can take that, or who need it.
Yeah.
But I think it's one of those, you know, like you said, it may be something that we're never able to. You know, it could be that the eye is, that it may be too complicated for a 3D printer for a certain amount of time.
Yeah. Oh, and do you know that there's a connection between the Twilight Zone and Planet of the Apes?
I'm not surprised, but go ahead.
Rod Serling wrote the first draft for the first movie. And really upset the studio, and they had somebody rewrite it who threw out a whole bunch of things. And then when the movie proved popular, they brought the elements that from Serling's script that they had thrown out and used them for the second movie. And that's why the apes come into the past, because Rod Serling originally intended the movie to be a commentary on racism.
On one hand, I can see that. On the other hand, that also sounds really freaking awkward.
Yeah, well, Rod Serling was... I stumbled across on YouTube, there's an interview with him done in 1959. It's him and Mike Wallace of CBS. And basically, Wallace is interviewing Serling as promo for when the Twilight Zone is going to start. Because the first season was in 59, I think, maybe 60. And Serling is just raging about racism in Hollywood in the interview. And it's shocking. Because it's not something you'd expect anyone to have said back then. And, I mean, he is just steamed. And apparently it was over a minor little thing. They didn't like that, you know, a minor character was black.
Mm-hmm.
In one of the projects. And he was just enraged about that. And I was looking something up online about an old car. And I saw there was a model, you know, that there was a Twilight Zone episode that featured that car in it. So, naturally, mm-hmm. I had to watch that episode. And the car was a 1920s car, and the Twilight Zone was set in the then present. So, you know, the car was 30 years old and was considered a clunker, right? And this kid, the guy, he's out, goes out to get in his car, and he hollers at the street kids because they, you know, he can't, it has to be push started, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the kids all run up and they push start the car. And I notice there's an equal distribution of boys, girls, and white and black kids in it. And then they all go back to playing with one another. You know, and that's a subtle thing. But it must have been huge back then, because you wouldn't have seen that back then. So,
well, Star Trek proves that once you slap a spacesuit on it, people all of a sudden can have that thrown in their face without getting upset, which is fascinating.
Yeah, and you know, one of the most jarring things about religion that happened to me when I was a little kid was because of Star Trek. I was watching the original series because that's all we had back then, and it was this episode where they go to this planet that is basically the Roman civilization existed there and never collapsed, and you know, they meet these people in outside the city, the main city, who are, you know, runaway slaves. And they keep talking about the sun, you know, and you think they're sun god worshippers. Well, at the end of the episode, no, they worship the same god as we do. And of course, at this time, it wasn't really firmly established when the series was set, right? Mm-hmm. And I was like, wouldn't by that point in time they view the god we worship as like the gods the Romans worshipped, and they would not be doing that? There'd be something else.
No, some stuff is harder to get to slip through than others, because it wasn't until the animated series that they were even able to bring something like that up.
Yeah, but this, I was like 10 or 11 when I saw that, and I was like, you know. And it just, no, I don't think they'd be worshiping God by then. I think something else would have come along.
The Chancellor, the late Chancellor, was only partly correct. He was obsolete. But so is the state, the entity he worshipped. Any state, any entity, any ideology that fails to recognize the worth, the dignity, the rights of man, that state is obsolete. A case to be filed under M for Mankind.
The new civil rights movement.com Women describe parties they attended with Matt Gaetz, fueled by sex, cocaine, and cash apps. Report. Between 2018 and 2019, I'm sure it wasn't just those 2 years. U.S. Representative Matt Gaetz attended parties described by women who attended as fueled by drugs, sex, and cash, or digital cash apps. The first thing some of the women were asked to do when they got to the house parties in the gated community in suburban Orlando was to put away their cell phones. CNN reveals in a new report citing two women in attendance who spoke to CNN.
That's awkward.
Yeah. Well, I guarantee you that there's somebody listening to this who knows exactly where that neighborhood is in Orlando. Guarantee you.
Well, I was going to say, my thing with the awkwardness is that you have to turn in your cell phone. That's where I turn around and leave.
Yeah, well, the idea is they don't want them taking pictures and blackmailing people. But no, I can understand.
I don't care about that either. You don't take my cell phone.
Yeah, no, I can understand. It's, you know, a bunch of coked up dudes. Yeah, you'd want your phone. The men inside, a who's who of local Republican officials that often included Representative Matt Gaetz, did not want the night's activities documented. Except for Matt, who you know, would show pictures of the women to his buddies on the floor of Congress. The partygoers, at times dressed in formal wear from a political event they just left, mingled and shared drugs like cocaine and ecstasy. Some had sex. Yeah, among the partygoers was now former County Tax Commissioner Joel Greenberg, a close friend of Gaetz, who has been indicted on 33 federal charges, including sex trafficking of a minor. Gaetz has described Greenberg as his wingman. Yeah. I'm guessing that Matt is just mad he never got to meet Jeffrey Epstein.
Potentially. And here's my thing with it. It's like, to a point, as long as everyone is consenting to everything, I don't care.
Yeah.
My big problem is, of course, if anybody is underage, and the part that I just find frustrating is how, if the left even steps a toe outside of whatever, it's this huge, everything is awful, and then on the right, you have this kind of stuff come up, and it's like, oh no, it's fine, and it's like, okay, so we can't have. We'll take.
Al Franken.
That one's a tough one. That one's incredibly tough because there was about 8 or 12 people who were talking about him groping at the state fair.
I don't remember all the details. I just know that. The infamous...
Oh, I remember too many details.
Yeah, well, I just remember the infamous photo.
So, the photo itself, you know, if we take out all of the rest of the allegations that happened afterwards...
Yeah.
The photo itself, definitely not enough to make him step down, and yet they probably would have made him do it anyways.
Yeah, yeah.
Because... if you're a Democrat, you cannot be. And this is a problem I have with sometimes with people is, you know, the person, everyone has to be perfect. But nobody says what perfect is.
Right, right.
Except for maybe throwing around a couple of names, to which I go, okay, but you're still not telling me what perfect is.
Yeah, yeah.
You're just telling me who you want hired. And I don't know.
Yeah, well, it's like there was a, I think in Los Angeles, that there was this legal aid type of society. So they would, you know, if you had certain problems, they would, you know, they would take your case and, you know, they'd run you all the way to the Supreme Court if need be. But you couldn't have anything like a criminal record. And, you know, they had to rethink everything because a couple of the people who came to him said, hey, you know, there's a criminal gang of cops in this, running loose in this neighborhood. They arrest everybody sooner or later. You're never going to find anybody without an arrest record. And so then they figuring out, okay, let's not worry so much about that. Let's see what we, you know, if we can get...
And then what the question... Oh, go ahead.
Oh, you know, let's see, you know, what some of these people have been arrested for and if it is something that is just insanely minor, like jaywalking, we'll go ahead and take their case.
I was going to say, because, I mean, hell, I have something. I don't even know if it's on my record anymore. It was similar to jaywalking, where it was just, you know, it was, well, I will argue that the cop was an asshole. The cop would probably argue. Anyways, but I drove with the suspended license? No, wait. No, actually, this one was legit because I was got into an accident and I didn't have proof of insurance.
Mm.
I had insurance, I just didn't have my card.
Yeah.
So I had a bench warrant out because I was 18 and stupid.
Yeah.
So what ended up happening is I turned myself in and did all that stuff, and because I am Lily White, it went fine.
Yeah.
But
if you'd have been brown, you'd have gone down.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm not 100%. I don't think I would have been treated exactly the same. And the only reason I am making any notes about that is because there were, you know, it's like I get up, I go to the count, basically the holding center. They go, you know, get in line, go up to the thing. I'm here to turn myself in. Okay, go sit down. And I kind of went, what?
Yeah.
That part probably wouldn't have happened. However, there's a whole bunch of people of, you know, multiple cultures and such in that area, and I had no idea what anybody was there for, so I cannot say exactly how it would have changed.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, I watched two black guys get sentenced to jail for the same thing that I had done, and then I watched a white guy who not only had been arrested for the same thing 10 times, he had 9 failures to appear.
Oh, yeah.
White guy spent 10 days in jail. One black guy spent 6 months in jail. Another one spent a year in jail. I spent no time in jail.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The system is definitely an issue. Yeah. That I'm not arguing with that. I'm just saying I don't know if the cops would have, like, gone that far as to, like, pin somebody down when they're sitting in the thing. However, we've seen that kind of shit before, so I can't say they wouldn't do it either. I just didn't see it happen, so... back to Lily White Republican asshats. I want Gates to go down so bad. I would rather he not have sex trafficked a minor, to be honest, because my heart goes out to the victims in this.
Yeah.
Who may or may not realize that they are victims. Especially if somebody, because, you know, the right wing does hold these people as superheroes.
Yeah, yeah.
And so there, I could totally see a hero worship and a person not realizing exactly what was going on.
Although I don't know too many 17-year-olds who would be excited by a Republican politician. I'm sure they exist.
They exist, you know, especially if somebody lives in a evangelical home.
Yeah.
That's their whole life has been you get. I don't know if brainwashed is the right word. I don't think it is.
It's close enough.
Yeah, but it's because your entire life is this bubble, and it's almost impossible to get out of that bubble until you're 18.
Yeah.
And even then, you know, you haven't been given a lot of tools to work with.
Yeah, but...
So...
Yeah, but Gates is potentially looking at life in prison. I mean, he'll never see it, I'm sure. Even if he's found guilty and everything. But I wouldn't mind seeing him behind bars.
Oh, that would be so beautiful.
He's definitely a sleaze bag. Mr. Five.
Yeah. I love the fact that people have been comparing him and Green, whatever, to Beavis and Butthead.
Yeah.
Because I'm like... Because there was a couple other comparisons that was like, oh, come on, that person is actually pretty cool, or this happened with this, and it's like, okay, yeah, that's not... We can't compare these people just because they look kind of alike, and then somebody said Beavis and Butthead, and I was like, done.
Yeah.
And some people are like, oh, that's insulting to Beavis and Butthead. I'm like, if you only mean that as more insulting to Gates, fine. But Beavis and Butthead really didn't have a whole lot of anything good to contribute. I didn't, again, did not have cable, so I did not grow up with Beavis and Butthead, but it's like the couple times I saw it, I just kind of looked and went, why am I watching this? I could be literally watching paint dry, and I feel like it would be better.
Well, part of why they were so appealing, at least for people of my generation, was that we knew so many folks just like them.
Yeah. And as a kid during that time, I really didn't. Our next story is from Politico.com. Finally, good one. Capital riot defendant will plead guilty and cooperate with the government. Oh, John Schaefer, a heavy guitar medalist and self-described lifetime member of the Oath Keepers. pled guilty to charges based on his participation in the attack and has entered a cooperation agreement with the government. I am so curious how the leaders of the Oath Keepers are scared. Oh, I can't remember what the one, but there's one who's gone on Alex Jones' show several times, and from what I can tell from listening to Knowledge Fight, has not been on in a while. Mm-hmm. I wonder why that is.
Probably because he's in jail, or he's terrified that he's going to go to jail.
My guess would be a bit more the second than the first.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think, you know, less. Yeah. I definitely think it's a possibility. Alex Jones actually himself is going through, depending on how you look at it, he is actually legit scared something is going to be connected to him, or he is trying to use the factor that one of his staff members is in jail right now for going into the building.
Yeah.
To make money, which is entirely possible. It sounds like he threw that person under the bus super fast.
Yeah, well, apparently this is not the only guy who's flipped.
Oh, I'm not surprised at all. I mean, the fact that these people are flipping left and right, it's like, yeah.
Yeah, because they're... they're not really invested in their belief system.
Well, I feel that they are invested... until they get to the point when they realize there's consequences for their actions. Then all of a sudden they don't know what to do and they flake out.
Right, right. I mean, Martin Luther King knew going in that there would be consequences to his actions. And mm-hmm. he was willing to endure that because the results would be a better life for everyone.
Yeah. People who are protesting in my city... they know the consequences.
All too well.
Yes. For many, especially because of last summer. Not a new thing.
No.
Though I have heard Speaking of Minneapolis, I was going to actually ask if you wanted to go into that at all.
Oh, yeah. Since you're there, and I cannot bear to watch the trial. I've seen too much of man's inhumanity to man to watch anything dealing with a trial, because I know that footage is going to be in there and all that, and I don't...
Oh, yes.
I can't. I only saw a few clips of George Floyd screaming for his life, and that was more than enough.
Yeah, I fully admit I have not watched the trial. I've been getting my news through, you know, some social media stuff, some other stuff, because it's one of those. It's like, if I watch the trial of, and this is a personal thing for me, if I watch the trial every day, it's not solving anything. Mm-mm. For me.
Yeah, I know. I know there are
people who are watching the trial every day, and you know, I think if you can do that and you have the time to do that, definitely. That's also the other thing, is oftentimes this trial is taking place while I'm at work, and I kind of can't do the two things at once. From what I have heard, the prosecution has brought in some excellent expert witnesses and such. The defense has tried. The problem is that the jury has to be unanimous.
Yeah.
And that's where, again, for me, white woman, for me, that's where my big worry is, because all they need is one person to go, well, I don't know about that.
Yeah, yeah.
And it can fall apart.
Yeah.
So, with the Dwayne Wright shooting, which happened earlier this week, there's a lot of questions.
Yeah, yeah.
Kim Potter is a 26-year veteran. She is a field trainer, and she was at least at one point head of the police union.
Yeah, and tasers do not look anything like a pistol.
Nope. And here's another part of it. You know, a lot of people have talked about these things, and looking back at my own experiences, I can say there's stuff that I knew too, where you picked something up and you're like, that doesn't feel right. And to anybody else who, like, if you just picked random person off the street who did not do that thing, they won't know. For example, my favorite example was somebody who said that they worked at Arby's and they knew the difference between a 2-ounce sandwich and a 3-ounce sandwich just by picking it up.
Yeah.
Because you did it so many times.
Yeah.
I do think that part of this is part of this problem is training, and the training to go for your gun first,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to going for your taser. Also, the fact that that stop should never have happened.
Yeah, I know.
I don't care if she's field training. That stop never should have happened. Right now, Minnesota actually has a bit of a moratorium on having somebody brought over to the side of the road for their registration, because registration is super backed up.
Yeah.
Like, so they don't have the manpower to get all of those registrations done right now because of COVID. So like I said, increasingly frustrated, because there's no reason why this should have happened.
And it wasn't the registration that caused them to pull him over. It was the fact that he had air fresheners hanging from the rearview mirror, and he was brown.
Well yes. I have actually seen people, like, the whole thing hanging down from the thing is so stupid. I love Minnesota, but that is one of the stupidest things we have.
Yeah. Well, you know why they do that? Because it's an excuse to pull you over, and if they can find nothing else, at least they can get their money out of you. That's what it is.
It is. It's, yeah. So right now, protests are continuing. There have been The first night was a 7 o'clock curfew from Walls, the governor. Everybody, it was like one of those things. Everybody disliked this, especially because there had been a candlelight vigil set up for 7 o'clock.
Uh huh.
And I will state, it is entirely possible he did not know about this. It is also entirely possible he did.
Yeah.
If I was going to guess, probably didn't. I mean, admittedly, I don't want a governor who's, like, surfing Facebook all day.
Yeah.
So, either way, though, still super gauche. Even just to have the, because in my opinion, he shouldn't have had that kind of deadline anyway, or curfew anyways.
Yeah.
The National Guard has actually kind of, has been at the ready for the Chauvin trial, because they know that it's entirely possible this thing will not go well. Which is also going to have protesting and such. Like I said, I've been looking at some tweets coming out about statements being made by the Minneapolis City Council, who are all just a wee bit pissed.
Yeah.
Because the city is pretty much militarized. Now, I live north of the city, but the last few nights, with my windows open, I get to hear helicopters going back and forth.
Yeah.
All night. So it's great, is what I'm saying. It's just great.
Have you seen The Onion? I haven't read the story because, you know, what's the point? But The Onion headline talking about this incident.
Are you sure they're not just recycling the same one from last time? Which is recycling the same one from the time before that? Because Christ, we really have a problem.
No, this one is, it's brutal. Whoever came up with this earned their money. Minnesota police say officer accidentally discharged weapon after being startled by sight of gun in own hand.
I have actually watched a little bit of the video from the body cam, and to a point, it almost does look like that. Which is also interesting because Kim Potter has had a different issue regarding things some years ago, which is just shocking that a police officer in the Twin Cities would have multiple problems.
Yeah, I've never heard of any police officer in the Twin Cities ever having a problem before. No.
I was going to say, to be fair, Minneapolis is not the only police force that has problems.
Yeah.
I was like, I do live here. But we definitely are in the spotlight.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Charges have been brought up for Kim Potter for manslaughter, which I think is at least a good start.
Yeah.
I don't think she went into this thinking that she was going to kill a person. I think she's very, very thoughtful.
Yeah.
How does Eli put... I'm sorry, there's a way Eli puts it that... And I know it's his character speaking and not necessarily him himself speaking. But there are times when I do agree with it. Hello, officer for whom high school was hard.
Yeah. No,
which is an insult to people who have had a hard time in high school, to be honest.
Yeah, I know.
But most of them are doing wonderful, awesome, and amazing work, and sometimes dangerous work of not being a cop.
Yeah. No, there's the, you know, I've known some cops who, it wasn't high school that made them want to be a cop. It was this one cop.
It's the power trip.
Well, in his, I don't know, certainly might have been the power trip, but he was, you know, he said when he was a kid growing up, he watched Hill Street Blues, which was a cop show, religiously. And he's like, you know, when all these friends were out doing stuff, if there was a new episode of Hill Street Blues, he was at home watching it on TV. He didn't care. He said, you know, I that's what I wanted to be. So he wasn't like somebody, like there was a guy on some daytime talk show who was a cop, and he said one of the reasons he became a cop was he was a fat kid, and a bunch of people threw him out of the back of a bus because they wanted to see if he'd bounce when he hit the ground.
That's lovely.
Yeah, I mean, those kids are assholes, but maybe that's not a good reason to be a cop.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, he might have gone into it thinking, I want to protect the helpless and the weak, or he might have been like, I'm just going to fuck assholes up because they did shit to me when I was a kid.
Yeah. Yeah. So, have heard... I have heard through a grapevine that it sounds like the Minneapolis Council has put a moratorium on use of things like tear gas and rubber bullets and such. However, I do not know how far that goes. Yeah. It's already, at least from my view, there already is a break in the chain from the police chief to the police people, which I'm sure a lot of people will argue that the police chief is, you know, oh, he's totally in on this thing too, and I don't necessarily agree with that.
Yeah.
To me, it sounds like someone who basically inherited a frat house, and none of them are going to listen to him.
Yeah.
And they don't want to change the culture of what they do. So, and he can't, you know, he does not have he probably does not have enough power to actually make the changes that need to be made anyways.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's,
on the other hand, I could be completely wrong and he could be an asshole, in which case he should be fired out of a cannon into the sun.
Yeah. And that's a problem with the police unions who they're not really police unions, they're extortion rackets.
Exactly. If there's any place I'm pointing, it's totally at the police union.
Yeah.
It protects them from everything. It gets them high cost attorneys. It protects their pension. If, you know, Kim Potter put in her resignation, probably so that she can get her pension. The mayor of Brooklyn Park has not accepted that resignation, and right, at least as far as I heard last time. So whether or not she keeps it, still dependent. And even if she gets charged with manslaughter, it's entirely possible she'll still get it.
Yeah, yeah, that's...
Please also note the Brooklyn Park police chief is different from the Minneapolis police chief. They are two separate entities.
Right, right. And of course, it's kind of confusing because it's called Brooklyn, but it's not in New York.
Yeah. I've always kind of laughed at that. It's like, Minnesota, we have our own little Brooklyn.
Yeah. Well, I grew up in a small little town called New Albany, that's in Ohio. It's now much better known because the guy who owns the Limited bought the town, and he had that as the mail drop for a whole bunch of his companies, and there was, because he owned the Limited, Victoria's Secret. Gosh.
So basically Anorexia United?
No, because he did have, and I cannot remember the name of the company now, but they specialized in women's clothing that was not something you would, you know, people who couldn't find anything to fit them at the Gap would go to. And it wasn't because
plus size?
Yes.
That was because we just call them plus size stores.
Lauren something?
Lane Bryant?
Yeah, he owns that as well. And he owned.
I didn't know that was owned by the same.
And there was, he owns, it's not Body and Bath Works, but it's along those lines. It's also owned by them. And but anyways, nobody had ever heard of that town, New Albany, until he bought all of it. They'd heard of New Albany, Indiana. And so, like, if we were on a school field trip out of state and we're all wearing our high school jackets, because that's what you do, that's the thing, like it's the 1950s, people would often ask us, is that New Albany, Indiana? Because that was a bigger, better known city than the little town I grew up in, which was less than 5,000 people, so.
Yeah.
And I don't know how big New Albany, Indiana is, but, yeah.
Well, I was going to say, I think it's pretty easy, because usually when you say Brooklyn in Minnesota, you say Brooklyn Park or Brooklyn Center. Yeah, you don't just say Brooklyn.
Yeah, but if somebody said Brooklyn Park to me, I would have been like, I would have thought it was like something in New York. I would, you know, even and with the Minnesota, even if you said Brooklyn Park, Minnesota, I'd still been like, what? And then, of course, with this story coming about. To kind of shift back to the previous story, you do know that one of the Proud Boys who was there at the Capitol riot has the coronavirus.
I'm shocked, I tell you, shocked.
Yeah, well, he's in prison and has got all these problems, and that, you know, because he's got like some form of cancer. And he's complaining because, you know, he can't go good, he can't get good medical treatment in prison. Well, dude, guess what? That happens to everybody. And the folks of you, you know, those folks of out there who I'm sure you were one of who thought, well, if you're in jail or prison, you don't deserve nice things. That's the end result. And I mean, I wouldn't wish pain and suffering on anyone, but I'm not exactly shedding tears over this asshole. And I think that people who are in jail for whatever reason should have access to proper medical things, simply because we may have gotten it wrong, and you know they're still human beings, so they deserve decent treatment, even if they did do something terrible.
I agree with you on that. I also think that they deserve to get the treatment that's going on right now, because they are cishet straight white men who are conservative Christians and disturbingly have more power than many of us at this point. And it's like, well, maybe you'll change your not mind. Probably not, because...
Yeah, but I mean, they are definitely reaping what they've sown.
I would definitely agree with that.
Because they, you know, they definitely would have pushed for shit like this. You know, let's they're in jail. Fuck them. Don't give them any medical treatment. And then suddenly they wind up in jail. Oh gosh, maybe we should give people medical treatment who are in jail.
Joyce.
Yeah.
That's it for this episode of the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. You can subscribe to the show on iTunes, Stitcher, as well as just about anywhere else podcasts can be found. Many of the episodes are also on YouTube. Follow the show on Twitter at TeaParkAtheist is the show's Twitter handle. It's on Facebook at facebook.com/trailerparkatheist.com. If you happen to like the podcast, please rate it on iTunes. If you'd like to support the podcast, there's a donate button on the show notes page. You can support it via Patreon at patreon.com/TNTucker. Thanks for listening.
Say goodnight, Fuzznuts.
All I know is this violates every canon of respectable broadcasting.
Damned cat.